Good evening, everyone. I'm Rose Krasnow, Deputy Director of the Planning Department. And if my chair will stop talking, well, sorry, I couldn't resist. And we want to welcome you all here this evening to the third and last event in our winter speaker series. How many of you were here last time? I'm not trying to make anyone feel bad. Okay. I asked that because last time, at the very last moment, we found out that our speaker from Philadelphia wasn't going to make it. And so we got his PowerPoint and I kind of filled in for him. This time, late last night, we learned that David Cristeal from Arlington wasn't going to be able to make it either. So I apologize for that. We really aren't trying to do false advertising here. But perhaps it's the time of year with budgets. Everyone suddenly seems to have meetings that they cannot skip. Nevertheless, we have an excellent program for you tonight, and I do mean that sincerely. And it is going to be headed by Clarence Snuggs, who is the head of the Department of Housing and Community Affairs for the county. And he has Stephanie Killian, who is also from DHCA, and Kyle Talente, who's it's always almost like my initials because I'm RGK and he's RKG, so I always have to stop and think about that. RKG Consultants, and he's been working on our rental housing study. So I know we're going to have a very interesting program here tonight. And with that, I will turn it over to Clarence.
Thank you very much, Rose, and good evening, everybody. And this is, as Rose mentioned, the third in a series of three of the winter speaker series. Although today is the first full day of spring, I believe. So thank you. And I want to thank the Planning Department for the opportunity to be here tonight to talk about both zoning and affordable housing. I think it's a great opportunity, and I look forward to having a conversation with you. The first two events were, one was around, it was called From Farmland to Algorithms. Is that, oh my. Okay. Maybe I thought spell check had fixed that for me, but okay, great. How about From Parks to Energized Open Spaces? All right, great. And tonight we're going to get from innovative zoning to housing for all. Got that. Good, we got that part. Okay, so tonight we have, as Rose mentioned, we have two brave souls with us. We have Stephanie Killens, who is the county's manager of affordable housing for DHCA, and Stephanie's right here. Thank you very much for being here. And we have Cal Taliente, who is the principal at RKG. He's also a well-known speaker, and I think, what was that? There was something about the SAG card or something like that. So thank you. And I am Clarence Snuggs, as Rose mentioned, and I have the striped shirt, so I get to be referee for the group, and I will try to control the time. So this conversation tonight is just that. It's not a lecture. It's a conversation. We'll bring some insight and data, and we will be looking to engage you as part of this conversation. So I want you to jump in as we get going on this, and hopefully we can have a really good conversation. So we have a lot of experience here, and I think we're going to put some things on the table, but I do want to make sure that we engage each of you in this part of the conversation. Just as a bit of background, so what's the challenge that we're trying to address tonight? And I would say that for me, as the director of housing, that my boss would say, it's housing. And the shortage of affordable housing units countywide. And this is not just a Montgomery County issue. It's not just a Maryland issue. It's a national issue. And some would say it's even an international issue. And this didn't happen overnight. This is something that has been evolving over time. It's an issue that we have a significant amount of support from our leadership to try to address, but the challenge is significant. And I'm going to give you a few numbers. I'm going to try not to give a lot of data, but I will give you a few numbers in a few minutes. But we do want to try to use our inclusionary zoning to achieve what I call equitable development results and avoid some of the concentration. So we're looking at the zoning part of this and trying to understand that. So let me give you a little bit of background just to kind of put this in context, and then we're going to go directly to Stephanie, and then we'll come to Cal, and then we'll come back with some questions, and I'll open it up for some discussions. For those of you who were here, how many people lived in Montgomery County in 1970? Okay. In 1970, the population of Montgomery County was about 523,000 in 1970. In 2015, the population was about 1.1 million. And that's an increase of 517,000 souls to Montgomery County, 98.9%. The housing units in Montgomery County, for those that were here, there were 161,000 housing units in Montgomery County in 1970. And in the census said in 2015, 389,000. That's an increase of 227,622 units, or 141% increase in the number of housing units. So somebody's going to ask the question, well, so how many people per household was that back in 1970? 3.24. And what about now? 2.67. You said, wait a minute, that doesn't make sense. It seems like it should be a lot more. But what's missing is the type of units that were produced. There are a lot more, and I don't have the data here, but there are a lot more what we call zeros and ones, efficiencies, and one bedrooms that are included in that number. So it's not the same housing stock that was being built in 1970 necessarily, where we had on the rental side 2 and 3 bedroom apartments being built and townhouses and single family detached that were 3, 4 bedrooms. So it's a lot different in 1970 than in 2015. The other issue is something that I'm sure you've heard about, which is something called housing burden, which says that anyone paying more than 30% of their household income for housing is burdened. And there are a number of people that are paying significantly greater than that number. The number originally started out at around 20%, went to 25%. And in 1982, I think it went to 30%. So it hasn't changed since 1982. So I'm not sure that's a good number for 2017. But that's a number that everybody uses as a basis to try to get a sense of what people are facing. But I would suggest to you that people are not only housing burden, they're also healthcare burden, they're transportation burden. You know, they're burdened with, you know, the cost of medication and food and all kinds of things in their lives. And so it's really a relationship between housing and the cost, the income that's being produced. And we could go through some numbers, but right now I would suggest to you, if we were able tomorrow to produce the number of housing units in Montgomery County that we needed to make sure that everybody in Montgomery County was housed paying no more than 30% of their income for housing, we would need today 50,000 units of housing just to deal with today's population. We need 50,000 units of housing. And that's assuming that the population doesn't continue to grow, and it is still continue to grow. I think the projection is at 6% growth between now and 2030 or something like that. And so you can see that this is a tremendous issue. And we've developed a number of tools over the years to try to address that, but we're gonna talk about a few tonight. But I just wanted to put that in perspective as we look at one of those tools, which is the issue of zoning, and tonight innovative zoning techniques, as we look to try to address the issue of housing production, housing preservation over time. And so just to get us started, I'm going to throw the mic to, not literally, I'm going to hand the mic to Stephanie, and she's going to walk you through a little bit of our experience, or the experience at the Maryland Montgomery County Department of Housing and Community Affairs with some of the techniques that we've used. So, Stephanie, thank you.
Thank you very much. It's interesting that Clarence mentioned the population of Montgomery County in 1970, because I have the statistics on 1960. And in 1960, the county's population was 340,000. In 1970, it had grown to over 500,000, nearly a doubling of the population. And in the 60s, the county had just passed the Agricultural Land Reserve, had passed a transit-oriented development general plan for the county. And citizens realized that early on, and we're talking 1964, 1966, changes needed to occur in this county to ensure that we had affordable housing. So the League of Women Voters and others pulled together resources, and by 1974 had passed the moderately priced dwelling unit program. But from the very early days, activists and citizens in this county realized we needed to be an inclusive county, and we needed to make sure that we had affordable housing in all areas. Now, when I talk to folks about housing in Montgomery County, I manage the MPDU program, and as Clarence knows, I like to complain that too many people think that all affordable housing in Montgomery County are MPDUs, and that's the only program we have. So I always try and start off with some information on all the programs we have, because it's pretty it's an amazing inventory of programs that we have. The first time I did this, I put it on one slide, and now I've had to do it on two slides. So on this slide, what you see are the programs we have that really look at generating affordable housing or maintaining and preserving the housing that we have. I'm going to talk in a little detail, not too much, about the MPDU program and make sure everybody understands the basics of it, but also talk about how we've used the Housing Initiative Fund, the right of first refusal, rental agreements, and even county land to try and create and increase the amount of affordable housing or preserve affordable housing that we have. Just to kind of run through them quickly what the programs are, the MPDU program is our inclusionary zoning program. The Housing Initiative Fund is a program that we use to finance a lot of activities, and I'll go through some of the others in a minute. Now, we also have a variety of other programs that aren't zoning-based as much or as major programs, but they still are incredibly important in making sure that we have housing and neighborhoods that are safe and viable for everyone. Our housing code enforcement, our landlord-tenant affairs, and our rental licensing section work together to really work with landlords and rental properties to make sure that they're well maintained and that they're providing the proper residences for tenants, and also to make sure that we have good relationship with our landlords and our property owners as well. I put here the scattered site affordable housing policy because I want to make sure that in every time we talk about housing, we go back to the fact that we have affordable housing in all our neighborhoods. Then the other programs that we have are focused on special needs housing and lower income housing, including the very strong and viable county rental assistance program that we have. As the federal government's decreasing its rental assistance, this county's increasing it. We have a significant homelessness prevention program and permanently supportive housing programs here, as well as initiatives by using county funds from our Housing Initiative Fund to make sure that as we do projects, there's some units that are for very low-income residents. These are the program goals for the MPDU program, but have really been the program goals for the affordable housing and for housing development in Montgomery County for a long time. It's to make sure that we have a full choice of housing, that not only were single-family homes being built as they were in the 60s and the 50s and prior to that, but now we can have townhomes and condos and apartments and all variety of housing that's being built throughout the county. The policy of the county has been to disperse moderately priced housing throughout the county in all areas and to make sure that all of our housing is financially feasible. When we look at our programs and look at our goals, we try and make sure that the programs work financially and that they can work to make development strong. Now, in terms of the MPDU program, many of you are familiar with it, but I did want to go over the goals and how the program works. We've created over 15,000 dwelling units through the MPDU program since the first units were created in 1976. About 10,000 have been for home ownership, and about 5,000 have been rental. I counted it recently. I think we have 57 rental properties that have MPDUs in them. The most important aspect of the MPDU program is that it's mandatory. If you're going to do a dwelling, any type of development with more than 20 units, you're going to be including MPDUs in it. And that makes it something that developers can program in their planning, they can budget for it. If they're from Montgomery County, every now and then I talk to someone from outside the county and they're like, what's this MPDU program? I'm like, hire a local land use attorney. Anyway, and so it's a mandatory program that people can plan for and they can make sure they know about as they're doing housing. Of the 15,000 units, about 5,000 units are still under control, about half of them home ownership and half of them rental. In the early days of the program, homeownership units would expire quickly. Originally 5 years and then later 10 years. Now it's 30 years. On the rental side, originally it was 20 years. We have had some developments that have expired and left the program, but we've worked out agreements with many of them to continue the MPDU type affordable housing after the covenants have expired. We do occasionally, rarely, allow alternative payments in this program. Even though it's mandatory, there are times when it just doesn't work. Since 2007, we've only done three of those. One was an alternative location, and two have been alternative payments. Our policy on that is it's at our discretion, it's the department's discretion. If it's that we think that the housing that'll be built will not be affordable to home buyers, and that's typically if the price of the housing plus the price of condo fees, high condo fees, would be too high for the owners to be able to buy. What we do then is accept a fee of 3% of the total price of the sale of all the units in the property, or 3% of the sale of each unit. Our program is linked solely to residential development. Some communities have linkage to other types of development. We don't. It is a residentially linked program. One thing I wanted to mention about the number of units we've created, Montgomery County was the first local government to have an inclusionary zoning program like this. Because our program's mandatory, because it's everywhere, our program has pretty much created as many units through our program as have been created across the country in other inclusionary zoning programs. New York and all the cities in California are starting to creep up a little, but total up all the other inclusionary zoning programs in the country, they all total the number of units we've created in just this county. We have had a number of amazing successes with the programs.
Can you just say that one more time? I heard you.
Yes. All right, I'll back up in 1 second. Ours was the first. A lot of jurisdictions over the past decades, especially the last two decades, have implemented programs that are like our MPDU program. Sidebar, many of them even called it MPDUs. And interestingly enough, a number of them have even used the same set-aside, 12.5%. And they, as if it's a magic number. No, 12.5% is halfway between 10 and 15. It's a compromise. Anyway, if you take all the other jurisdictions in the country that have had inclusionary housing programs and totaled up the number of units they've created, it all equals to our units, and it, until recently probably wasn't as many as ours. Our program has been that successful. We've created over 15,000 units in this program since 1976. It's hard to get exact numbers, but the last time I looked, it was like 10,000 to 12,000 nationwide. And again, that's only because New York and California have, in the last 5 to 10 years, have generated a lot of number of units. One of the reasons why is many jurisdictions accept what we call alternative payments. They pretty much don't require MPDUs except for rental units. That's a norm around the country. This county is unusual in that. No, you got to do them. I mean, it's just like, what do you mean? Anyway, that's been one of the major, yes. The The total created, not existing, but total created, right. So that's why I put down as the number one success of our program has been the huge amount of units that are created, and they're created everywhere in the county. And one of the issues with the program, of course, it is dependent on the private market. If a developer's building a project, then he's going to build MPDUs. If nobody's building anything, hello, you know, the middle of the recession, then we're not getting MPDUs built. But it also is realistic. If nobody can buy units, they're also not going to be able to buy MPDUs. So there are some market and financing realities of that. We are looking at how the program will operate in the future as more high-rise buildings are built. However, today, the largest number of units that we have as MPDUs continue to be townhouses because they're between infill development, like this development here, and others. Infill townhouses continue to be built, and we continue to get a large number of MPDU townhouses everywhere in the county, from Clarksburg to Bethesda. One of the opportunities and successes of the MPDU program also has been that nonprofits and HOC can purchase units in a certain number of units in every development, or they can master lease them. In this development, one of the MPDUs that was built was purchased by a nonprofit that provides special needs housing. Kind of going into some of the ideas of how do we have housing for all, that's one of the ways the MPDU program has achieved that. We use our housing initiative funds and other funds to help nonprofits purchase units. So when you look at these pictures, probably one of those MPDUs in the top picture was a townhouse could have been purchased by Montgomery Housing Partnership and provide lower cost rental housing in a neighborhood. Nonprofits purchase condos in high-rise buildings and provide services and housing for special needs populations. One of the ways we do this type of financing is with the Montgomery Housing Initiative Fund. It's about a $25 million local housing trust fund. That's an amazing resource that this county's had since the early 60s. Today we have about $25 million a year to provide loans to nonprofit and for-profit developers of affordable housing. We tie to those loans long-term restrictions that the property has to remain affordable. We have as one of our goals to have at least maybe one or two very low-income units in the developments we finance, a unit at 30% or 40% of area median income. Since the Housing Trust Fund, our Housing Initiative Fund, is a local fund, it is completely local resources, we can set our own priorities. We can figure out as a local government what we want to do with that fund. And to give you an example, the county executive has, over the past several years, set a real goal of increasing senior housing and making sure that as areas like Silver Spring and other areas redevelop, White Flint, we're going to have senior housing in those neighborhoods. And so I've got a picture there of a unit at the Bonifant and what the community center looks like there. That's a project that we were able to finance with our Housing Initiative Fund. And again, we made sure to have some very low-income units there, as well as middle-income units, 50 and 60% of area median income, and some units that are market rate. That also will remember the Bonifant, because we'll talk about that in a second. One of the things I wanted to kind of go over was what can we do to create more affordable units and making sure that we're serving a variety of incomes. One is rental assistance. The county does use housing initiative funds and recordation taxes to finance a local rental assistance program. It's quite large. And this is for individuals. Rent generally don't tie this to a specific project, but what it does is make sure that people can afford housing. Another way we do it is that we use our Housing Initiative Fund to what we call write down the rents, meaning when a project is being developed, we'll make a loan to the developer that pretty much covers the costs of that unit. And so that the rent that the tenant pays at 30 or 40% of area median income is used, what covers the expenses of operating the unit. 30% of area median income, the rent that a household at that level can pay, generally does not cover high-rise construction, especially operating expenses. And when you get to about 40% of area median income, it does. I know that sounds very technical, but I just wanted to explain that if you're going to get, if we're going to serve households that low, generally the solution is cash. And it's cash at the development table or it's rental assistance. So we also give money to the housing from the Housing Initiative Fund to nonprofits and other groups to preserve or to create new affordable housing. And one thing we've been doing is using county land. As I mentioned, the Bonifin a second ago is the development that's next to the Silver Spring Library. That was a great project to work on and it was an exciting opportunity to create housing in downtown Silver Spring. We have another project underway next to the Silver Spring Police Station up in White Oak. We have four in the planning process all around the county, from White Flint to the Burton's Village area to Germantown to Silver Spring. And there's actually five in planning in White Flint. And we will, on each of those, make sure there's a mix of income. That's how we do things. So we'll have some market rate units, and we'll have some rents at 50 and 60% of area median income. And then we'll try and make sure that we have some units for lower income households as well. We also do use our resources to preserve the existing market rate housing in the county. We have a right of first refusal program that gives the county the first right to step into the shoes of a contract purchaser, and we can snatch that property and we can buy it, or we have a nonprofit or buy it and make sure to maintain the property long term. We also use rental agreements as a technique of doing that. It's a short-term way of preserving a property, but we write an agreement with the with an owner of a property. Usually it's the purchaser of a property. And get them to agree to maintain affordable rents in a property for a period of time, usually 5 to 10 years. And when we can extend those, we try to. Since the 70s, Montgomery County has had a very strong condominium conversion law and protections for tenants and properties that are being converted to condominiums. And we've had to kick those rules into high gear a couple times over the years. In the 70s, we had a condo conversion uptick, and about 10 years ago, about around 2004, 2005, we did as well. 3% of the sale, there's a fee tax, a condominium conversion tax, that a converter has to pay. And on the conversion of a unit from rental to for sale, they have to pay a 3% tax. And that was actually the start of the Housing Initiative Fund. Then we also, as I mentioned, we use Housing Initiative Funds money to finance the acquisition of a property that we think's at risk, that's and the community thinks at risk, that providing market rate affordable housing, it's privately owned, and we want to get someone in there who's going to keep it affordable long term. We've been trying to, as a department also with our Housing Initiative Fund, using innovative financing techniques where we'll put equity into a deal to try and work with a property owner where we get an equity partnership into the deal, an ownership in the deal, and can work to maintain affordable rents over a time period or do other types of innovative financing techniques. So Clarence and I are, you know, glad to describe these programs to you. When I also, one other thing though, when I talk about the MPDU program, I also do try to address the issue of, do inclusionary housing programs stop development in its tracks? Because that was the claim in the 1970s, and the claim, I get phone calls all the time from jurisdictions around the country saying, will it stop development? Well, the picture up on the top is looking east of Montgomery County, and the arrow points to the Washingtonian Tower. And the picture on the bottom is the Washingtonian Rio Center. And no, development hasn't stopped. Our population has doubled, and so has our development. As Clarence told you, the number of housing units that we've had has increased dramatically. So it was an amazing gamble that people took back in the 70s to really have this policy of affordable housing everywhere and being an inclusive community. And I'd say it's a gamble that has greatly paid off.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate that. I'm going to throw one question at you just to reflect on the 40 years plus for a moderately priced dwelling unit program or inclusionary zoning. And that, to me, MPDU stands for opportunity. And that's what the program allows us to do, create opportunities throughout the county for working families and individuals to be able to get started and to be able to live and work in Montgomery County and in the area. But just a reflective question over the 40 years, and I know you weren't here in 1970 working in this position, but just kind of looking back through your files. So from a zoning perspective, has inclusionary zoning worked?
From our department? Yes, I would say this picture shows that it's worked. We've created the units, we've housed people successfully, we continue to house them, and the market has been able to take the elements of the MPDU program and work them into their financing and work them into their budgets. So yes, it has worked. It's worked both for the folks who live in the housing, and it's worked for the community as a whole. And the development community has managed to figure out how to make it work.
Thank you, development community. I'm gonna pass this to Cal now, who's gonna help us wrap up a bit on reflecting on not only the history of inclusionary zoning, but also his experience in other situations and maybe some observations to go along with that. There is an opportunity, there will be a lot of opportunity for Q&A at the end of this conversation for both Stephanie and Kyle and myself if you have questions. So I didn't want you thinking that there wasn't a chance to jump in there if you wanted to. So I'm gonna throw it to Kyle.
Thank you, Clarence. I appreciate the opportunity to be here and talk about this. We have spent, for my friends here at DHCA and MNC-PPC, an inordinate amount of time together over the past several months going through the rental housing community here in Montgomery County. And I want to start by answering the question that you just asked, Stephanie, and my response is it's worked and arguably too well. And the reason I say that is when we got into our analysis, we looked exclusively at rental housing, and so I'm going to focus from that perspective. But when we looked at the information, what we saw was when you matched up people's incomes to the pricing of rental housing in the community, when you hit that 65% of AMI threshold, we have a substantial amount of housing in that price point for rental housing. And so more than if you look at when you talked about cost burdening earlier, more than the amount of households that earn that much to occupy housing. And so I'm not here to say that that's a bad thing, but when you look at it from a market perspective and you try and look back over 40 years and you say, well, what are lessons learned that you took away, Kyle, from your work? My response to that question would be, well, you know, it's great that we set a target. You know, you said 12.5% was somewhere between 10 and 15. Well, I would have to imagine at that point in time, 65% had maybe had some value back in 1976, but, you know, over the years was never re-looked at. And that was one of the pieces when I looked at your MPDU slide is it was set at 65% of AMI back then, and it continues to deliver units at 65% of AMI today. And I say all that to say is when I look at supply and demand balance across various incomes, you see substantial unmet demand at 50% and below, and substantial unmet demand at 120% and above. And you say, well, why would I need moderately priced dwelling units priced above 100% of AMI? And I would argue you're correct. The point isn't that we should be delivering moderately priced units for people who earn over $120,000 a year as a household. But the point is that we focused on one particular target area, and that's where we've been delivering since then. So what we're trying to identify ways is how do we take this visionary and frankly nationally recognized program and take it to the next level? And that's getting to the next question you had for me, which was, well, what are we looking at another places doing? And you're right. When you go and look at what we call inclusionary zoning or moderately priced dwelling unit is, Montgomery County has been the gold standard since the 70s, and it continues to be in many regards. But what we have seen is, and I appreciate you mentioning like California and the West Coast, is people are starting to innovate on that. And they're starting to take a look at those programs and try and be more strategic about matching it to need and to what the opportunities are to say, well, we don't want to deliver it just at one price point. And one of the examples we looked at is there are communities that say, okay, rather than just 12.5% at 65% of AMI, we want a certain percent at 50% of AMI, certain percent at 80% of AMI, and even down to 30 in some communities where they say, we're going to look at that. Now, in those situations, they adjust the percentage requirement because of the financial impact. To say, I want 12.5% of units priced to someone making 30 grand has a substantially different financial impact on a deal than someone making $65,000. And I'm using those numbers, by the way, because they're relevant to Montgomery County. Your 100% of AMI is about $100,000 in this community. So it makes the numbers easy for me to remember, but also I want you to understand why I'm using these. I'm not just throwing these out as wild, you know, pulling them from the air. And so from that perspective is, how do we take an extremely successful and an extremely revolutionary idea and then go to what I call version 2.0? Like it or not, in the digital age we are, everything is 2.0 and 3.0. And so where we are in our process is trying to work with your organization, MNC PPC, and then bring the community on board saying there are different innovative ways. For example, and I'll give you the perfect example, you mentioned other communities. We did a project up in Somerville, Massachusetts, right outside of Boston, if you're not familiar with that area, where they had set it at 12.5%. of the total units had to be inclusionary zoning, and my guess is it came right out of your playbook. And so what they had a number of community activists that said, well, we want it to be 20%, and the planning department said, why? And they said, well, we think that's the right thing to do. And so they retained us to look at, well, what is the financial implications on a deal going from 12.5% to 20%? And what we learned was in that particular example that the smaller the project, the harder it was hit by that percentage change. And so their innovation was, well, we'll do a lower percentage for smaller projects, a mid percentage for mid-size, and then we'll go up to 20% for larger projects. And I think they used 50 units and above to say, if you go, because theirs was at 8. Somerville is a small town, not a large county. And so theirs was anything 8 units above fell into the inclusionary zoning. So I think it was 8 to 17, 17 to 50, and then 50 and above, and they ratcheted up the percentages, recognize that you can absorb that cost on a bigger project when it's spread out. So that's an example, if I were to kind of wrap up with and then open the floor for questions, is how do we innovate to the next level so that we can continue to not disrupt the delivery of units, because that is not our intent, but find ways that we can try and match some of that need in the community a little bit differently than we have for the past 40 years.
Okay, so we have the controversy now. So we're gonna open it up for a little discussion. I do want to make a couple of observations before we get into the Q&A, and that is, one, Stephanie mentioned the Housing Initiative Fund that we use to help produce and preserve affordable housing. But we don't just, you know, it's not used to finance a single deal. It's not like we go out and say, okay, we're going to finance this deal with the Housing Initiative Fund. Those funds are leveraged with other existing, both private as well as other public funds to try to maximize affordability. And so she's right. I'm not saying she was correct. Just taking you one step further. And if, for those of you who are familiar with any projects that involve affordable housing, you know that there's at least a half a dozen sources of funding that's involved in that. And we use the appropriated funding from the county sort of as that but-for piece to make that deal work, to make that deal sustainable, and to hold that affordability for a period of time. And do some creative things also from time to time, like the Bonifant or Progress Place and a number of other things that we've done recently and some things that we have on the drawing board right now. So I'm just wanting to let you know that it's a combination. Every deal is different. And it's a combination of looking at projects, the right place, right time, trying to figure out a way to leverage those resources and to make that happen and to have it be sustainable. I don't want to see a deal become unaffordable nor have it at risk of failure as a result of just poor financial structure or financing structure. So that is out there. MPDU is not free. I'll say that again. It's not free. It's paid for. There is a cost associated with it. And we have to be appreciative of that cost. So there's a law. and the law requires it. But we have to look at the project because we don't want it. We don't want the project to go away and not happen. Nor do we want to create a situation again where it's not a sustainable outcome. So we want to. We do a lot of negotiating with our development partners, both for-profit and not-for-profit, around this issue and some trade-offs, especially as we look at priorities. Now, in 1974, when MPDU was created, in 1976, when the first deal was closed, up through now, MPDU has changed a lot. There's been a lot of flexing going on with the program to try to respond to local conditions at the time. So it's not the same Oldsmobile that we had back in 1976. Okay? And there's a lot of wisdom here in reflecting over those years, not all of those, but reflecting over that time and some of the lessons that we've learned and some of those lessons that we've shared with our peers around the country. But it's not free. The M in MPDU stands for moderate. It doesn't stand for low. It doesn't stand for high. It stands for moderate. That's what it was intended to do. I think some of the success is the fact that we stuck to our knitting and over the years and stayed focused on trying to create those opportunities. I'm not countering what he's saying because he's good. I get you riled up. I'm trying to get to the kids are watching. they're over there, right over there. See the guy in the orange shirt? That's one of his kids. Anyway, so we do. I just want to put that in perspective, and you know, zoning policy, financing policy, change in local environment. This county has changed significantly. It's in a very dynamic now. You know, some of the issues that we dealt with 20 years ago are totally different from what we're looking at today. Will be totally different. We don't have a crystal ball. Gwen sitting in the back. I know she has one upstairs, but I don't get to see it. And Casey may see it sometime, but I don't get to see it. To look to see where we're going to be 25, 30 years from now. So at best, we have to just kind of use what we know and do our best shot at sort of projecting that out. And hopefully we don't get too many unintended consequences 20 years from now. But we have had some, and we had to deal with those. But we do want to continue to use this tool. We have other tools in the toolbox. There is no one tool that's going to solve all of these challenges. And so we want to try to give some thought to that as we go forward. So you've gotten a little history on MPDU, some perspective on things that are going on outside of that. We want to get back to our theme, which is dealing with innovative zoning and housing for all. So I'll open up for any questions that you might have for the panel.
And just wait 1 second for the microphone.
My name is Wayne Sherwood. I'm from Tacoma Park. A couple of questions. One is there's been a lot of articles about the Purple Line, and I'm wondering about the county strategy towards either creating or maintaining affordable housing in that corridor. Is there some kind of a plan, or do you just kind of sit and wait until developers come and say, we've got a property or this and that? I mean, I saw a great presentation by the University of Maryland College Park, and they showed all the different low-income and minority communities on there that are going to be heavily impacted. The second part of the question is, I live in Tacoma Park, what can the city do? They usually say, well, this is really, the county is the only one that can do anything about these things.
As far as the Purple Line is concerned, once it comes, and I do expect that it will come, one day. I do believe that it will create a great transit link, a cross-county transit link. I am not yet convinced what real economic impact it will actually have. As we look at community economic development initiatives, one of the things that we know from history on transit projects is that you have to create destination points. Otherwise, people are just going to ride from one end to the other end, and if you can't get them to stop, they don't spend money, you can't create economic value. And therefore, that doesn't translate the way that a lot of people have. But there is a concern. We have been working with the University of Maryland, along with a number of other community partners that work in that corridor, to address and come up with a plan around housing. Garrett Knapp, I think, may have been the person at University of Maryland that you heard speak on this issue, and we are engaged with with him and others in trying to come up with strategies to position ourselves to preserve what we call market rate affordable housing. But I don't want to lose sight of the fact that that housing needs to have a certain quality to it. We're not just trying to put people in bad places or keep them in bad places. And so the economics of that is a challenge that we face. The good news would be that this project does create an economic engine, does help to revitalize a portion of that corridor, and we are able to use it to attract additional outside investment to that corridor, and that the folks that live there now would have an opportunity to benefit from some of that investment as a result of policies that we're able to wrap around. But what I don't want to do is to choke off potential investment in that corridor by getting too far ahead of this transit project, which is its role is to create a link from Bethesda to New Carrollton Metro and a number of stops along the way. We hope that there's an opportunity to leverage that and create some economic engine, but I can tell you that there are 11 metro stops in Prince George's County that have little or no economic impact on the community. And so we can't say guaranteed that the Purple Line will do that. But we have seen in other places in D.C. and Northern Virginia, Montgomery, where transit stops have created and resulted in economic engines. And we want to make sure that that doesn't create additional displacement for the folks that are there who are living in market rate affordable housing. So the answer to your question, I believe, is yes, we're working to develop a plan around affordable housing, around the Purple Line corridor, but with the knowledge that we have to be conscious of the fact that we don't want to run off investment, nor do we want to create a situation where the market's out of control. So we want to balance those two things. And I'll be honest with you, I don't know. I can't remember the second question, but. It's all of our business, and I think every player in the county, every jurisdiction, municipality, community organization, resident has a role in this, in sharing their voice and helping to try to create the environment, that the quality environment that we all want to live in as we from now and as we go forward. And so I believe that the city of Tacoma Park and your elected officials do have a role in that process. And I think that we can leverage resources, we can work together on planning, we can come up with strategies. I think there are a number of things that can be done to try to preserve quality of life and affordability. Okay. Thank you.
Hi. Clarence, when you introduced the subject, you talked about housing burden, and then you ticked off a few other burdens, and one of them was transportation burden. And I'll use MPDU, and I know there's a lot more than that going on, and I know that MPDU may be modified a little bit based on the experience of Somerville, Massachusetts, and other places. But a MPD unit that's located at a transit station, whether it be a Purple Line station or a Metro station or a future BRT station, the folks that live in that unit there, as opposed to the folks that live in the MPD unit in Damascus or someplace that's nowhere near regular transit, they aren't as transportation burdened because they have an opportunity to live with fewer cars, zero instead of one or one instead of three, whatever it may be. So my question is, how does that currently or might it in the future crank into your thinking about how the MPDU program and the related programs are operated?
Parking requirements and requirements for providing opportunities for parking are different around the county depending on the access and proximity to transit. MPDUs generally affordable lower income households have fewer cars. They can't afford them is often the issue. So they do have a slightly different parking requirement. And that whole issue is handled here at Park and Planning and is looked at very carefully when a project is approved. You talk about transportation burden. I recently took a tour with the developer of the Bonifant, which is the elderly housing project, senior housing project next to the Silver Spring Library I mentioned earlier. And the developer talked a lot about transportation burden. Well, we ended up having to build the Bonifant with no on-site parking. And I'll tell you, I was like, this is crazy. As the developer, I was very concerned about that. We met several residents when we took this recent tour, and they all talked about how they moved in with their car, they parked them in the parking garage, and after 6 months, they sold their cars. And they loved not having cars. If they needed to get a vehicle, there are a million ways to get one these days. And they talked about how much less they were spending on transportation and how much their quality of life had actually improved because we weren't able to put parking in the building. Now, one thing I do always try to remember in the back of my head is that when we talk about development in this county, as you mentioned, development in Damascus is very different than development in Bethesda or Silver Spring or downtown Wheaton and other areas like that. So when we planned for townhouses in MPDUs and a more spread out, less dense development, they do have parking that comes with it and their requirements for that. And generally it'll be one parking space, one car garage instead of two car garage or things like that. But we do try to make sure that the MPDU residents have at least some access to parking. Often in new developments that are being planned today, they'll assume no parking for the MPDU residents if they're in a parking lot district like Silver Spring or Bethesda. And the assumption is the MPDU residents will use the public parking spaces, parking lots. A lot of times we have owners who aren't that crazy, aren't pleased with that decision that we've made. But that's generally a policy decision that we require less parking in the transit areas.
Just to give some additional perspective on that, and Clarence mentioned earlier, HUD has changed their cost-burdening thresholds. There has been a fledgling effort with HUD and other think tank organizations to try and come to a combined transportation housing burdening metric. And a lot of times they're throwing around 45% saying if we combine your housing and your transportation, with the intent of saying there are differences in someone who lives in the Bonifant and doesn't need to own a car as opposed to living in Damascus and is life dependent upon one. And so there are efforts to go that route, and I would not be surprised in the near future, less than 10 years. I know that 10 years sounds, that's not near future, but when you think about planning, that's tomorrow, is you're going to get to the point where Montgomery County and other communities are going to be looking at that joint metric because there's going to be something for which to measure against. There's going to be the data sources for you to do that. And so I think that is going to have a profound impact on how you can get someone into those units, because to the point of the Bonifant is, if I can reduce my transportation costs to low or next to nothing, that frees up resources, and can I then pay more than 30% of my income towards housing? And so then what that 65% of AMI metric that we're using today changes, because I can use more of that towards that housing cost. But I think it's a real conversation, going back to your base question, your initial question, which was, not all MPDU units are created equally from an access perspective. And apparently I'm going to be the controversial speaker tonight, Clarence, so I will take that role on with full gusto, is one of the conversations that we have had during the rental housing study process is, are there locations that are more valuable to preserve or to deliver additional units than others? And that goes squarely against, do we need to spread our units out and make it equal throughout the community? And I'm not here, I want to be very, very clear, unless you're going to hire some security to get me to my car, my children are with me, by the way, just in case you're thinking of doing anything, keep that in the back of your mind, do we go to a value-based system? When we started talking about tools for preservation, for example, One of the recommendations we had is score your existing apartment complexes, and one of them is access. Access to services, access to retail, access to transportation. And so as we make decisions along those lines, are some areas more valuable, quote unquote, to us than others for that particular reason? And I think that's a struggle that this community will continue to have to keep revisiting over time. I mean, we're looking at it today, and Clarence, you made the point, our issues today may not be our issues tomorrow, but I think that's one that I would recommend the community continue to come back to, because the reality is, as we move away from that, and even if you look at economic development like telecommuting, is when getting to your job becomes less important because you can do your job at home, how does that affect location? And so I think that's a very real issue that will, I think, needs to be continually re-looked at as you move forward.
So I noticed a lot of the programs that we've focused on are geared towards the 65% AMI or senior housing. And I know, I'm curious what's being done essentially for the, call it 80 to 100%. I know there is workforce housing, very limited opportunities, and, you know, there's obviously an issue with that. And at the same time, you hear the study that we need more housing built at the 120 plus and the lower end. So what are the solutions? If I want to go somewhere, if I want to live somewhere and still hit my, you know, 30% of my income, what's being done for that?
Well, first of all, I think for the most part, we all live in affordable housing. It's a relative term. But when we typically say affordable housing, we're really talking about housing that, you know, people that can actually, you know, get into that housing unit. But if I'm at 100% of AMI, I don't want to pay more than I need to pay for the quality of housing that I want to get. So when I was asked a question recently about the need for housing, I said there's a need for housing across the county. And it goes from the spectrum of folks that are at risk of homelessness, who are looking to stay in their unit, but because of the cost increase, they're starting to get squeezed. And so they're at risk of homelessness, and having additional supply might relieve some of that pressure in the competition. All the way across to the folks who say, a number of parents in the county have said to me, I really want to get my child out of my basement and on their own, but they can't afford to do it in this county. It's just too difficult as far as costs are concerned. You know, get a roommate, they can go out and, you know, compete, but it's very difficult. And a lot of that, I think, goes back even to for the folks that were a part of the creation of MPDU, was to try to create opportunities so that folks that grew up in the county could actually stay in the county. When I first came to this area, and I came to visited Montgomery County, and I talked to some of the housing officials here, you know, one of the fastest growing cities, towns in this state was Frederick. And a lot of those people that were going to Frederick were from Montgomery County because they grew up here, their parents were here, but they couldn't afford to live here. And they were going to places like Frederick. They weren't all going to Frederick, but they were going to places like Frederick. So to try to answer your question, I think there's a need, and when you look at the supply demand across the economic spectrum, there's a need for more housing, period, to match the demand that's out there. I think there are a number of folks that are sort of mismatched. And if we can create some different types of affordable units for millennials, for seniors, you know, seniors that don't want to live at the golf course anymore, and there's nothing wrong with living at the golf course. They want to be where it's hip too, you know. And so you get this interesting, cross where you have seniors and millennials in the same place, and they're having a ball. But, you know, but it's the smart growth, it's a smart living that's attracting them where they're close by, you know, those resources. So to try to answer your question, I believe there's a need to continue to produce a housing across the spectrum. And that will open up opportunities for folks who find a better solution for them. For instance, there's a right on, is it Fenwick? The Octave, which is micro units, condos, two blocks from the Red Line. I think they're sold out. It was a conversion. It was an office conversion to micro units. And I think initially there were no parking spaces there. They put some there, I think, on the site of the building that's going to be the next building for now, just to get through that initial shock that the lender had. What do you mean you don't have any parking spaces? Right, they're on the garages on one side, and then there's a surface lot on the other side. They use some of those. I think they have 20 or 30 parking spaces. But the point is that those folks came from someplace, and hopefully they freed up an opportunity. And we won't end up with situations like we see in other jurisdictions where somebody's staying, you know, the family had a three-bedroom unit, and one person is living in a, you know, the three-bedroom unit because it's, you know, it's cheap. And therefore they don't want to move, but there is a family out there that's in a one-bedroom unit that needs space. And so we need to try to figure out a way to satisfy that need affordably and allow that to free it up so that we can preserve the existing supply, but at the same time increase production.
My first observation is, and I can't believe that we haven't hit this before, is I think you came up with a wonderful solution, which is how do we augment our locally funded housing voucher program by tapping parents and letting them pool their resources. We can do a parent-based housing voucher program so they can make it affordable for their kids to move out. I can't believe we haven't come up with that before. But I think, I mean, being more serious, getting back to your question is, it's an astute observation because what's being built in the market rate isn't 100 or 120% of AMI, it's 200 and 300% of AMI because that's where, listen, I'm not a developer, but I will tell you, if I was about to build a building and I was going to rent housing, I'm going to go for the market that will pay me the most, that has the depth of demand. And because this is a regional issue, and because this is not just a Montgomery County or a Metro DC, but because this is a problem, I have a substantial unlimited tapped demand pool that goes well beyond the county. And that's another challenge that we have is we put these units up, but it's not guaranteed that existing Montgomery County residents are going to be one that are taking them. And so when you're delivering to a sector of the market that is highly unobtainable for most of us, is how do you look at strategies where it's not just 65%, but we look at other ratios? And that is one of the recommendations that we are vetting through this process is, you know, how do we look at, and I mentioned earlier, and I have my little cheat sheet of notes here, is like in Santa Monica, California. Their percentage of unit delivered is based on the AMI that is being targeted in that program. And so you can slide and scale it to say this project would be great for 100% of AMI because of A, B, and C, where that project may be great for 30% of AMI because of A, B, C, and we adjust to try and make sure we're meeting all those unmet needs, particularly for new construction. But I think you're 100% where I will jump back on the bandwagon, if you will, is I think that part of it is that downward pressure because there's so much more demand than supply. And I'm not advocating, we're not going to build our way out of this. I will tell you with 100% certainty from my analysis, we cannot build our way out of this. But the reality is if we put more product on the street, it creates greater competition, which can help normalize pricing and help folks in the 80 to 100% of AMI. So I think it's a multiple solution, but I think that's worth noting.
Back on the issue of workforce housing and serving that income group, my first house was not a brand new house. I don't know about any of you, but most of us, our first house that we had when we got right out of college or started working and had enough money to buy a house, I bought a 20-year-old one-bedroom condo. You know, my second house was a 40-year-old house in Frederick, by the way. As an administrator of a workforce housing zoning-based program, this is me personally talking. I do have some concern about a zoning-based one that looks at creating new units. When we're building units at getting the marketplace to build units at 100% of area median income, we base them on affordability. Interest rates have been low, so we've been creating units at $380,000 each, $400,000 each. I've said to my boss, I didn't go into the affordable housing business to create $400,000 homes. But we have a huge inventory of existing single-family homes out there. We'll be announcing programs coming up on homeownership initiatives. We want to get people back, into that housing. As Clarence would say, we have a lot of families there, maybe who are in, you know, one person in a four-bedroom single-family house. They don't know how to fix the house up so they can sell it, things like that. Or there's a household that wants to buy that unit, that house, single-family house in Aspen Hill or other areas, and they don't have the resources to fix it up. And we're going to start looking at ways of bringing that connection together because, at least my personal experience, is workforce housing is existing housing that's maybe 10 years old or 20 years old or 40 years old. So that's what we're going to be looking at.
I'm serving on the planning board. My housing experience in the 40s and 50s was in public housing in Jersey City, and then in rental housing in Somerville in the 50s and 60s. Moved to Montgomery County, and we did purchase a home in 69, which I'm not sure I could afford at this point in time. But anyway, my question, I'm sure there's a good working relationship between you all and the staff here, but in terms of the master plans and that we do, do you see anything that maybe needs to be tweaked from your standpoint that you haven't been able to raise in the past, or are there some things that could be done in our master plans to meet the housing needs, affordable and otherwise?
We have an absolutely perfect working relationship with planning, and we couldn't have a better partner with the staff, and I think we've grown to get more involved and better understand perspective. They've listened to us, and we've listened to them, and I think we both have gained as a result of that, and we look forward to continuing it, because the challenge that's in front of us is going to continue to be out there, and we're going to have to be as thoughtful and creative as we can, and we're lucky to have folks who come to planning and come to housing with experience from other places that we can leverage to see if it works. But every deal is a new deal, and we have to try to make sure that we structure it the right way with the best knowledge that we have at the time. And so that's where the flex is, and that's where we have to have some discretion to be able to work through that. And so we're going to hope to leave some of that on the table and not try to plan it down to the last degree, but leave some flexibility in there so that we can be responsive and we can respond to both what we're hearing in the community as well as where we see the need, on the ground at the time. Well, the working relationship is good, and I think we're going to continue to make connections. I think as we both get a better view of the issue, and we kind of look out over the horizon, I think we will see things, and we can have an opportunity to discuss those. But I think wanting to be as transparent with policy as we can. And because developers don't like uncertainty. Nobody does, but so they want to know what's the deal? How does this work? And we're going to try to put as much of that down and be as clear as we can. But at the same time, we have to have flexibility to be able to be responsive and to be able to sort of fold into that changes in our priorities as we go forward. One of the lessons that we learned in the housing business was a need for diversity of income and diversity income. If you concentrate poverty, you create problems for yourselves. And we've allowed social policy sometimes to get in the way of that when it comes to housing. And we have to be aware of that. But at the same time, we're in the business of creating opportunity. We have to value that opportunity. This is where we have some really good conversations around how we value that opportunity that MPDU and other things allow us to be able to create. And if we're going to make trade-offs, we have to get full value for that trade-off. But you got to be able to quantify that first. And if we're going to put, what does it mean for a working class family to be in the central business district of Bethesda and to work there? What does that mean? And then if we're going to move that someplace else, then what should be the leverage that goes with that? That's a concept that we're working with, and planning is helping us better understand that.
Hello. I'm a Montgomery County landlord. I've practically born and raised in Montgomery County, worked in Montgomery County all my life. Right now, I primarily rent single-family homes, but by room. And what I found, most of my tenants tend to be working millennials who they don't have the option of living in a family or friend's basement, but they just can't afford an apartment of their own. And so to me, that's, moderately priced dwelling, even though I know you have the, 20-unit limit. But it would be nice for it to be considered you know, those landlords who rent by room, because right now the landlord, it can be very restrictive sometimes, particularly with the 5-person limit that there is for single family homes. Right now, you know, there's so many tenants who are looking for affordable, nice and safe rent by room that I just don't have enough space for them all. And because of the limit, even though I may have the space in the home where I could fit many, I just can't based on the 5-person limit. Also, some of my tenants tend to be not just working millennials, but much older people who are just transitioning in their lives. I get a lot of divorced people, or people who are, you know, recently retired, but they can't afford an apartment themselves as well because they're paying alimony or have child support or some other issue that they just don't have the money. So I just wanted to mention that. As a landlord, though, and I love Montgomery County, I am looking at purchasing apartment units in the 20-plus range. So I had a question about that as well. The other stuff I said were more comments. My question is for, and I jotted it down, if I purchase an apartment building that's already 20-plus units, should I assume that the MPDU is already, that it's already compliant? And then also, at what point in developing of a property, should I reach out to the county about ensuring that I'm compliant? Or is that something that you do when I apply for the development? And then the last thing, could you say a little bit more about that, the density bonus? Because when I do get to the point, I'd probably like to do more than just 12.5%. I'd like to do more for the community. Thank you.
Several issues. One is the MPDU program is an inclusionary zoning program. So it is triggered when development occurs, when new development occurs. So if you're rehabbing or an existing home or restructuring an existing home, it would not trigger the MPDU program, even if you did 50 of them. I mean, it's a zoning issue. If you're going through subdivision, the MPDU program is triggered. Now, if you are purchasing apartment buildings that are over five units, anything, the county does have a right of first refusal. I mentioned it briefly, where you have to submit the contract, the signed contract to the county to see if it wants to step into the shoes of the contract purchaser. So if you're sounds like you'd be on the purchasing side, you need to make sure that the owner is working with the county to make sure that process goes through as quickly as possible. Our Office of Landlord Tenant Affairs works with landlords and makes sure that single family homes are well maintained and licensed properly. Single family homes are one of the largest elements of our rental housing stock. So it is a very strong part of our rental housing stock, and one that we value because of the benefit it provides to the community. Room rentals are a slightly different breed, or regulated slightly differently, but it is still an important source. But yes, you would, if you're looking at buying properties, definitely check with the county. If you're looking at redeveloping and going through a subdivision process, that's when the MPDU program is triggered. But as I went through that whole list of slides, there are lots of other opportunities. You can, if you have tenants who need rental assistance, you can get them to work with HHS. So you can work with HOC to be an HOC housing choice voucher landlord. So there are lots of other programs available for your tenants, and also services provided. If you're having senior citizens that are your tenants, you might work, make sure they know about the resources that are available at HHS. So that's when the other programs mostly kick in.
I would say from time to time, we will have training sessions, both for landlords as well as for tenants. And we have a number of those that will be coming up over the next few months. We have some, you can go to the website, there's information on the website if you haven't done that already. There are a number of professional organizations in the area that you may want to consider joining or aligning yourself, where they also share good information about what's going on in the industry and how to look out for some of the potholes that are out there. You know, when I look at our landlord-tenant area and our commission, I would say to you that 80% of the sort of the reverse 80-20 rule, that 80% of the complaints that we get come from 20% of the landlords, and most of those landlords are small landlords. We don't have the same, you know, types of problems because the large ones have, you know, they know. They have staff that have been out there for a long time. They've worked with us. They know the law. They have, you know, they have good guidance. And some of the others that are kind of evolving from one phase of real estate into the next phase of type of real estate, sometimes it's, there are things that get lost in the transition. So I'd say look to us for training. Go to our website. Look to some of the professional organizations. I won't miss in any initials, but they're out there. Look to align yourself, and that will be very helpful to kind of, stay watch those potholes and to stay on the right side with us, because we do have a regulatory part of our job, and we take that very seriously.
I actually have two questions, and one is just something I really should know, but I don't know, and that has to do with the fact that Kyle keeps telling us that we have more than enough units for those making 65% the average median income. How do people know even how to access the program? I mean, I really don't know the answer to that.
It is interesting that I've seen the statistics that the need at 65 to 70%, by the way, our maximum 70% for high rise and for home ownership, is met by the, and those of us who know about the MPD program, you know it's met by the MPDU program. If you go talk to the landlords, there are, a building will open up and will be 100%, the MPDUs will be 100% rented. We have MPDU tenants that tell us they stalk development sites and they walk around and they look and they are signing up, and as soon as a project development says, you know, leasing office, they're in there with their name on the list. And so it's rare for there to be any vacancies. As a matter of fact, I don't know of any vacancies that are in any MPDU rental units. We will find out occasionally 60 days in advance somebody's given a notice, and we may know a turnover is coming, but they generally don't have vacant units. To ask how do they find out about them, we have a list on our website. We send out blast emails to people who sign up through the gov delivery service for Montgomery County. We'll send out notices when apartments, when we get notifications from developers and owners that our units are available, which is rare. We're going to start putting on our website a pipeline that lets people know when we've signed an agreement to build with a developer, meaning a project is being built, and we're given estimated delivery time. And then we're also going to put on our website when offering agreements are being negotiated, which means the property is ready to open up and will be available for rent. So that we're also, HOC has guidelines and other people have booklets to talk about the affordable housing that's available, and they list the MPDU developments as well.
But your for sale units, are you totally,
That was rental. Everything I just said was rental.
That was rental, I know. And I guess on for sale, I've often heard people don't like the fact that they can't get the appreciation out of the unit, so they sometimes.
On the for sale side, people have to, in order to sign up for the program, they have to get what we call a certificate. That means they're eligible to purchase an MPDU. And the reason we do that is we make people take training classes. Back 10, 15 years ago, people would sign up for the MPDU program and then couldn't figure out why they couldn't buy one when they only had $10,000 in income. So we now make people take a first-time homebuyer class, an MPDU orientation class, and an MPDU application seminar where they turn in their application. Somebody asks you, where is an MPDU application? It is not online. You have to come to the class and get it because we want you to understand what you're filling out when you do it. When somebody buys an MPDU, we restrict the price. So a typical townhouse, a three-bedroom townhouse, would be about $150,000, $170,000. It might have a market price. Other houses in the development are being built $500,000, $600,000. But these MPDUs are, or more, these MPDUs are $150,000. When that owner goes to sell the property, we restrict how the maximum amount they can sell the house for. And they can, the calculation is what they paid for it plus a CPI increase. And so generally, MPDU owners can get an increase of about 2 to 3% a year on resales. Again, that's the maximum amount that they can sell it for. They can sell it for less if they want, but I just sold my house in Frederick. I didn't make a 2 to 3% appreciation a year on my house. I sold it for less than I bought it for. But that's the market sometimes. So there are instances where, especially where there's certain types that are difficult in the MPD program for anybody, and that units with high condo fees. But I never like to say never, but it is rare for someone to not at least cover their purchase price in the MPDU program, and most people sell their units, sell them with the CPI appreciation. Joyce,
I know, but she has a direct response on that question. As one of those people that was around in the 70s and working on these issues, there was no intention for this to be permanent housing or to make people rich. What we were finding was that the kids that grew up in this county couldn't stay here. And that meant that Frederick got our soccer coaches and our volunteers. And our community was denied those opportunities. And at the same time, we had mothers standing up in public hearings and saying, if my kids can't afford to live in my neighborhood, they can jolly well go someplace else. So there is those kinds of pressures and back push. But I've sold a lot of MPDUs, and the purchasers, the sellers, walk away with enough to move up to their next house. I think that's all that our obligation is. And I think that one of the things that's really, from my point of view, stifled this market is this 30-year control period. If we didn't have that, we could be serving many, many, many more families in these houses. And that makes me sad.
Yeah. That's an issue in across the country. Those of us who work with the MPD program every day have a different opinion than housing advocates across the country. Across the country, the concept is perpetual affordability. We have such a huge amount of homeownership MPDUs, which is unique across the country, that when we talk about perpetual controls on MPDUs for homeownership, it makes it difficult in the implementation. We're looking at other ways of making it work, and we're going to try and be creative about it. But it does mean that we'll have 60-year-old modest condos in Germantown that have 30-year controls on them. And we'll, if it goes on, we'll have 90-year-old modest condominiums in Germantown with 30-year controls on them. These aren't rentals. These are homeownership. And so that's one of the things with our MPDU program. We definitely need to always remember the homeownership component as we look at changes in it.
As the mic works his way, I have a 25-minute rant on this issue, so I won't give it to you right now. But I'll say that we're on the same page. I think that they should be set free at some point, and that they're used as a pathway, as an entry into the market. But if we keep them forever, it's called public housing, and that's not what we're intended to do.
Can you hear now? Oh, okay. I've read this document. I am a longtime advocate for affordable housing, among other things. But I read this document with great interest. I like to think about what I consider the gold standard for affordable housing, and that's the big cities of Western Europe. You all, those that I've mentioned this to, think that's completely unattainable here. But looking through this booklet here, I realized that if you put together the things that various people that write these articles are saying or in most cases are doing, you come up with that gold standard for affordable housing. And so I want to urge you to think more comprehensively. The thing about the European cities is that they put all the elements together into a system, and that system could be applied here. And I'm not going to try to explain it because it's pretty subtle and complicated. But as I said, the elements of it are all in this booklet. And I do want to, I'm not going to take you through all of the people's comments, although I did set out, I wrote down notes from what everybody said in this booklet to show people what was relevant, what was important about what each of these people said. But if I can just read you a few quotes from this document, I won't take up much of your time. There were speakers or article writers from every branch of the county, both the county employees and the other interested parties in the housing business, starting out with Paul Wiedefeld, the chairman of the Metro, the WMATA. He said something that really rang true to me. He said that there's an essential partnership between affordable housing and public transit. If you the public transit ride users are often lower income people, and on the other hand, the public transit system depends on letting these lower income residents and workers and employees have a good access to the public transit. That's one. And then listening to, reading of what Stacy Spann from HOC said, from Lawrence Cager from your housing department, and another project. All of these projects had all of the essential elements, and they produced big projects right at metro stations at ideal locations with high percentages of affordable housing and reaching lower than the MPDU level. Now, if these situations can be increased, like HOC's big projects or that Stacy talked about, or the Chevy Chase Lake project, which was a partnership with EYA developers. Mr. Cager talked about the Bonifant, which was actually developed by the MHP, the Montgomery Housing Partnership, with the cooperation of Donahoe developers on county property. You see, we are getting the essential elements out. And then what was the other one? That anyway, you get the point.
Yes. And I can tell you, and I appreciate the observations, and I can tell you that we haven't looked at everything, but we have looked at, and we continue. Go ahead.
I haven't come to the bottom line yet. The bottom line. All right. But I was the last to be called on. Keep that in mind. The bottom line is that I think that in downtown Bethesda, there are opportunities to produce more of these situations. That the main ingredients of the situations are affordable housing providers involved, some sort of county land. There's a lot of county properties or public properties in Bethesda, county-owned land, and cooperation, public-private partnerships between affordable housing providers and private developers. And there are a few more, but if you maximize the situations where those can all come together, it can make a real quantum difference in how much affordable, how much good quality, perfectly located affordable housing gets produced. Enough.
I couldn't tell if there was a question or an observation. It sounds like an observation, and I just want to let you know that, as you know, we're constantly looking at every opportunity, and we're looking at co-location. There are a number of projects that have been delivered and are underway right now, where we're leveraging public land to create not only a public purpose like a fire station, police department, library, you name it, a government office building, and at the same time, we're looking to create affordable housing on the same site so that we can get the advantage of that, the cost of that land. I mean, it is smart to put affordable housing at a metro station or near it, but the cost of the land in buying that is very expensive because we're competing with the private marketplace, but there are opportunities, and we try to find those opportunities. We're constantly looking for those. Okay. We won't debate that, but we are looking at that, and we're looking at how we can leverage the opportunities that have been identified, and they are being responsive to the community that's there at the same time. And I know that's a bigger discussion than the time that we have now, because I see the hook coming out. Okay. Hello? Can you hear me? So I just want to say that we are, we have a strong commitment from our leadership at County Executive, as you know. The department is constantly working with its partners to try to identify opportunities, both for-profit as well as not-for-profit. We're going to try to use the tools that we have in the best way that's possible. Zoning is obviously one of those tools. Financial resources is another tool. To be as smart as we can with the resources that we have, to produce as much as we can, to preserve as much as we can. That's not easy. It can be difficult, but we see the models that are out there. We've looked at from tiny houses to shipping crate houses to prefab. We've looked at it, and we were trying. But every situation. I didn't mean to cause. But we're constantly looking for solutions, and we're working on that. So I just want to make that observation. And we work with our partners who are very creative. We typically are in that deal with them to make that deal work on the ground financially in order to make that work. And so we're there. Okay.
So let's give a big hand to our panelists and to our audience. Like Stephanie, I think affordable housing is a subject that as a planner has always been near and dear to my heart, and it is one of the toughest issues to really not even solve, but just to try and improve the situation. And I would argue and would have loved to have asked you a question if we had the time, given the proposed federal budget and what it might do to housing in general in this area, and how will we prepare for that. But the rental housing study, we presented the recommendations to the board last week, week before, I can't remember which, and we will soon have a rental housing report and that will then go to council for further discussion. It does definitely propose changing the MPDU law, so I urge all of you who have an interest to take a look, because I know some of the things will be controversial and some will never happen, but I do think it's really worth a good analysis from all of you here. And I want to thank you all again for coming and thank our speakers, and I hope you all have a wonderful evening.
One really quick announcement.
Hi, sorry, really fast. I'm with the Affordable Housing Conference of Montgomery County, and I just wanted to quickly say that if you are interested in discussing affordable housing in Montgomery County further and hearing more from Clarence and Kyle, please attend our annual Affording Housing Summit, which will be on May 5th in North Bethesda. And, you know, feel free to come up to me afterwards. But they're going to be speaking, and we're going to continue to talk about issues like the rental housing study and other potential solutions to kind of, you know, aid in affordable housing access in Montgomery County. Thanks.
Great. Thank you, and thank you all. Thank you.